What is going on, ladies and gentlemen? EM Ultra Uprising here with you today for the WWE Raw Review for the 17th of October, 2016. First Raw Review I have done in some time. I actually kind of lost some interest in Raw. I hadn't really been watching it the last few weeks. And more importantly, haven't really had a whole lot of time to upload very many videos. But this week will be a little bit different. Today, I'm doing the Raw Review. On Thursday, we're going to be talking about Survivor Series, kind of giving my preliminary thoughts on that. And then finally, this weekend, there will be, I promise you, a Q&A video. So if you do have any Q&A questions you'd like to ask me, go ahead and do that in the comment section down below or via Twitter, which you can follow me at in a link in the description. Anyway, without any further ado, let's go ahead and review this show because we have the return of Bill Goldberg. Who's next? You're next. Wow, crazy stuff to see Goldberg in the ring for the first time since 2004. So Goldberg, unfortunately, did not come out until the very end of the show, so we had to basically wait for 3 hours to get what we really wanted out of this episode of Raw, which was a Bill Goldberg appearance. And we had to wait all the way until the end of the show to find out if he was going to go ahead and accept the challenge that Paul Heyman had laid out the previous week. So unlike WWE, I'm not going to make you wait for my reaction and my thoughts on Bill Goldberg's return. I am going to go ahead and give you those thoughts first and then review the rest of the show after. Hope that sounds pretty good. Let's talk about Goldberg. So I've always liked Goldberg. I've always been a fan of his. He's never been one of my favorites, but I've always enjoyed his past work, especially his WCW stuff. His WWE run wasn't really a whole lot to write home about, primarily that final match he had with Brock Lesnar, which was one of the worst matches that I've ever seen in my entire life at WrestleMania 20. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, then you don't need to see the match because it was bad, enough said. Honestly, Goldberg's return was something that I had looked forward to for a long time, but the fact that he's coming back to face Brock Lesnar again is kind of disappointing, but it also does provide an opportunity to right the wrong. It does provide an opportunity for a match that was so bad, but yet could have been so good, to potentially come out a whole lot better when both guys are putting in 100% effort. Not to say that I'm expecting the match to now suddenly be a five-star classic or anything like that, but I would certainly be excited and would like to see it work out pretty well. Either way, I'm going to say Goldberg's return tonight was pretty cool. Once that music hit, he was coming out, making his entrance. It was a cool moment. I'm pretty sure that most of us can say that you kind of had the kid in you or the younger version of yourself kind of like, man, here he is. Like, this guy, we haven't seen him in forever, and now here he is in front of us live. It's actually pretty amazing. It was kind of surreal that he was actually there. It was cool when he did the punch in the air with his, the fireworks going off and like the energy from him. It was good. It was good energy. It seemed like he was glad to be there. And he cut a pretty enjoyable promo. Like, it was nice. It was well done. And I don't think it was like out of this world good, but it was nice. It was a fun and enjoyable segment and a way to end the night. And it's too bad we had to wait 3 hours to get there. I understand what WWE is trying to do there. I see you guys, but, it sucks to have to wait that long. But it was definitely a cool segment, and we will be getting Lesnar versus Goldberg, which, you knew that was going to be his answer, but it didn't matter. It was still a cool segment to see, and again, like I said, I got chills when that music was playing and the crowd was yelling, Goldberg, just that whole, combination of things. I was like, man, this is cool. So it was a nice moment. It definitely was well done, well executed. And I'm glad that he is coming back to wrestle a match. I would have been fine with him coming in for a Royal Rumble spot, what have you. It doesn't really matter to me. I just wanted Goldberg to come back at some point. I'm not really loving the idea of him versus Lesnar because I have a horrible taste left in my mouth from their 2004 match at WrestleMania 20. But let's see if they do right the wrong. I only think it's fair to give the benefit of the doubt and see what happens this time around. I mean, you're getting it whether you like it or not. So if you're that upset about the match, this is my two cents. If you're that upset about this match to a point where it infuriates or triggers you, then what I say is just don't freaking watch it at all. I mean, you're doing yourself a disservice if you're going to watch a match that you're going to crap on no matter what. that pretty much covers my main and true thoughts on Bill Goldberg. Cool to see him come back. I enjoyed the moment, and I would give the segment a thumbs up. Now, as far as the rest of Raw goes, we started things off with Chris Jericho and Kevin Owens, and the camaraderie between these two guys is spectacular, and tonight was actually a night where there was some build-up and some furtherment of this idea of a potential problems developing between the two, some tension coming into play that we saw here throughout this night, including a backstage segment where the two kind of were starting to get into it with each other, with Stephanie McMahon had to try to talk them out of the argument. This all coming after Seth Rollins and Chris Jericho had the first match of the night, in which Rollins ended up getting the win. Jericho had asked Kevin Owens to stay away from ringside so Jericho could prove himself in this match, but Owens did not actually listen to that and ultimately did come out, and Jericho then would blame the distraction on why he lost, even though Owens was trying to provide the distraction to help Jericho win. And now next week we're getting a triple threat match between Jericho, Owens, and Rollins, which I'm really looking forward to. However, I would have rather had that match just go ahead and be what takes place at Hell in a Cell. In fact, I think the first match of the night, if I was the booker, I would have had this be Seth Rollins versus Chris Jericho, with Jericho having a chance to be in the Hell in a Cell match on the line. Jericho gets the win, and it leads to a triple threat match for inside the Hell in a Cell, which would have made things that much more interesting going into the pay-per-view. But hey, I guess I don't know what I'm talking about. Anyway, the opening promo was pretty enjoyable. I don't think the sparkle crotch thing was all that funny, mainly because in the Book of Jericho, and on the list of Jericho, an entire list of things that make Seth Rollins a loser in comparison. Ignore the calendar. Seth Rollins is a loser for 1,000 reasons, and that is because he does not know how to drink it in, man. The list of Jericho is that much longer now just because of Seth Rollins. That bastard won 2 consecutive matches against the great, the only, the one Ayatollah of rock and roll. That will never happen again, not on my watch. Let me tell you that much. Anyway, we're going to move on now to Charlotte and Lita having an interview. Actually, Lita had an interview with Sasha Banks as well, and the interviews, at least as far as the one with Charlotte, felt very robotic and forced and scripted, whereas the one with Sasha was a lot more organic seeming, at least from my view. But I'm glad that we did get a bit of an introspective on the two going at it for the women's title inside Hell in a Cell. It did kind of give you an introspective, which I thought was nice, especially since neither one of them was actually in a segment tonight. Moving on, I'm going to say Mark Henry, Golden Truth, and Mark Henry and the Golden Truth defeated Titus O'Neil and the Shining Stars. An absolute waste of time, and I have no idea why Titus O'Neil got pinned by Mark Henry. What a shame. Let's just move on, because I got nothing else to say about that. Then we got the Jericho Owens backstage argument, which I did like. And then we got a Big E versus Sheamus match, where Big E got the win. Basically, I looked at this match as one big promotional tactic for WWE to try to get people to care about Facebook Live when WWE's, I guess, live streaming on Facebook or something, because Cesaro was recording the match and we kept getting a look of what it looked like on the screen and stuff. And like, it just seemed like one big promotion for Facebook Live rather than an actual match. And it's not a match that I really cared that much about anyway. I just love New Day making funny and obscure references, and also making quite an obvious reference tonight with the 420 sign that they had while in Denver, Colorado. I see what you did there, New Day. Not only did I see what you did there, I think everyone saw what you did there, but it was still awesome nonetheless. So Big E gets a win over Sheamus, and they're still building up this whole thing that Cesaro and Sheamus don't get along well and all that, and they're going to end up winning the tag titles. You can almost like see that all kind of coming into play. I'm not a big fan of the way that Cesaro and Sheamus ultimately ended up a team after all these matches that they had. Very drawn-out process to just ultimately make them a tag team. However, I do think that they will work well together, and I think that the match that they will have with the New Day will probably be pretty enjoyable. Anyway, let's go ahead and move forward. Bo Dallas defeated Neville next, and I'm going to move forward from that because I don't really care. Oh yeah, and Bo Dallas beat the crap out of Curtis Axel. Good on you, Bo. Moving on, Dana Brooke defeats Bayley. and a terrible botch to finish this match, where Dana Brooke was supposed to put her feet up on the ropes to get the pinfall, but missed, and then it looked like an awkward three count. Yeah, Dana Brooke and Bayley, I guess that's going on. I don't even know. I really didn't watch the last couple of episodes of Raw. No offense to the Raw, and I apologize for not really doing too many reviews, but this is a large portion of why. You know, you have a couple of segments that are good in this night, and then you get to the middle of the show, and it's just a bunch of stuff that kind of, like, chains one after the other of stuff that isn't that important, doesn't do that much for a story, isn't that entertaining, and in fact is more memorable for the botch at the end of the match than anything that happened during it. I'm going to move on now to Paul Heyman, who made comments on Goldberg, said that it was a bad idea for Goldberg to accept the challenge of Brock Lesnar because you don't want to piss off Brock Lesnar. He's there's no one else like him and whatnot. So that was a nice little bit of a interlude to keep you entertained. And they did show some cool clips of Goldberg throughout the night as well, retrospecting his entire career, which I thought was awesome and well executed as well on WWE's production team part. Next we got Braun Strowman taking out three jobbers and me yawning at it because I'm tired of seeing Braun Strowman, a guy who's probably like 6'8", 290, whatever he may be, probably over three. He's a massive man, a power lifter, guy is a truck of a human being. And he's taking out these guys who weigh 180 pounds. It's like, I don't care if there's five of them, Braun Strowman, the dominance has been established, right? So on that same token, since his dominance has been established here, now it's time to move into the credibility phase of building this guy into a star or building him into a big deal, as far as I'm concerned. Because I actually do think there is something with Braun Strowman. There really is. There's a sign of a monster. He's got the capability to be someone who we can take seriously and who we can look at as a legitimate power guy. Can. Doesn't mean we will. Doesn't mean they won't turn him into a joke. But I believe that the guy can be a big deal. And I think a lot of that starts with moving from the dominance factor to the credibility factor, which is giving him guys who are actually employed by WWE on a full-time basis and actually having him get important wins on shows and on pay-per-views over said guys. This could include The Big Show. This could include Mark Henry. This could include guys who are in their 40s and way past their prime and are basically jobbers right now. But it's more impressive for Braun Strowman to defeat Big Show, a guy who's a former world champion, than it is for him to beat three unknown guys. It just is. Name recognition alone does make the climb to the ladder there. It's an actual climb. Instead of him just kind of plateauing where he is right now, now you'll start to see an increase. So Sami Zayn ends up coming out, and Braun ends up shoving him out of the ring. Sami Zayn is not really the ideal candidate for Braun Strowman, in my opinion, right now. I think Sami Zayn needs to find a direction right now, and if he's going to end up beating Braun Strowman, it doesn't help Strowman either. So I don't really think either one of these guys are at the right place or right time to be feuding right now. Just my opinion, I think this feud can be really good. I'm not saying it can't be, but I just think it's wrong place, wrong time. Zayn needs to be better established on the card, and so does Braun Strowman, before those two guys would have a cool David versus Goliath feud, which is likely what we might see out of it. I just don't think WWE really knows what to do with Zayn right now, so here he is. Either way, at least it's someone on the roster. I'm not going to bitch and moan anymore. I'm just going to say, thankfully, WWE is giving him some seemingly legitimate competition. To move forward, Rusev and Roman Reigns got into it tonight, a bit of a brawl in the ring, which led to Rusev kicking the absolute crap out of Roman Reigns, getting some much-needed momentum before they have their U.S. title match inside Hell in a Cell. We already know Roman Reigns is 99% of the chances are that he's going to retain the championship. I would pretty much bet on that. But at least they're trying to make Rusev still look like he can kick the crap out of Reigns, because he not only super kicked him, but smashed his head off the steel steps, which looked amazing, and then put him in the accolade while on the steps. Rusev, before this, along with Lana at ringside, oh my god, Lana, was talking about his family and, his heritage and all that stuff before Reigns came out and interrupted it. So, this was a segment that was pretty simple, pretty well put together. We got a lot of matchkas thrown in there, and we got a lot of momentum on the part of Rusev. So I'm pretty happy with it. I think it was good. It did what it needed to. It served a purpose, is basically my view on it. I didn't love it necessarily, but it served a purpose, and not only that, but Rusev got some much needed momentum. So pretty solid. Moving forward, Big Cass defeated Carl Anderson. And the only thing that came out of this match for me was not only did I, A, miss most of it because I just happened to flip the channel over to Monday Night Football for like a minute and the match was over. And secondly, what it does is just make me realize how the WWE does not take Karl Anderson, Luke Gallows very seriously as a tag team. And what a shame that is, because the club, they're a great duo, but they are not taken seriously by WWE, and you can just tell that based off the fact that they don't ever win matches, which is a pretty consistent thing that I've noticed over the course of the club's tenure in WWE. Wow. Really, 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 really bad. That's on the list! Anyway, I'm going to move on. That's getting old, isn't it? It's getting old. Everyone's kind of saying that a lot, but I needed to say it at least once. I'm going to move on with the final match of the night, the final thing we're actually going to talk about here in this review, which was the six-man tag match featuring the Cruiserweight division, where Brian Kendrick, Tony Nese, and Gulak defeated Rich Swann, Perkins, and Cedric Alexander. And TJ Perkins and Brian Kendrick will have their match for the Cruiserweight belt at Hell in a Cell. And this match kind of helps build it up while also featuring the division. Okay, a couple of things about the Cruiserweight division. Number one, I'm still a huge fan of the fact that they have purple ropes and different feeling to the match. It feels like it's a whole special section of Monday Night Raw, which is exactly what I wanted it to feel like. Second thing about it is these guys are amazing athletes, and we get to see that on a week-to-week basis, and I think we saw that on display here very effectively in this match. This was a nice six-man tag. This was well-executed. There were some cool moments, some cool moves, some wow moments, and that's exactly what you need out of the Cruiserweight division. I think there is a bit of a disconnect, though. The fans don't seem as interested in a lot of these matches as I think that many people would expect them to be, and I think a lot of that has to do with a lack of recognition. It's not that it's like, oh, that's not entertaining. It's just like, who are these guys, you know? There are a bunch of guys who just came from this, you know, Cruiserweight Classic, and unless you're a WWE Network subscriber and a hardcore fan, you probably didn't see the majority of those matches or the tournament at all. So to be fair, I think that there's a kind of a loss in translation there. Brian Kendrick's the only familiar name for most of these people out of these six guys. So it's kind of hard for, I think, a lot of like casual fans to really relate to them. You know, it's not to say that they're not entertained by what they do in the ring, but they're just a little less into a match where they don't recognize the characters or know what the characters are all about, their motivations, where they come from. You know, we don't get as much of a backstory with these guys as maybe we should get. So instead of just having them just go out and wrestle, I do think that there should be a little bit of an added element to the Cruiserweight division. However, nonetheless, this was a solid match. The heels ended up getting the win, and I look forward to Kendrick versus Perkins. This was a nice match, and I'm not bashing it. I'm just saying that I think there are still improvements to be made with the division. That is going to do it for this Raw review, guys. I really thought this show had its ups and its downs. It was like a C-plus night for me. I think Goldberg's return was pretty cool, and it was a nice moment, so that's definitely a nice thumbs up for me. I think the stuff between Jericho and Owens tonight was all thumbs the hell up. That stuff is always good as far as that goes. Then we had some, you know, blah matches thrown in there, 3, 4, 5 in a row, and it just doesn't do a whole lot for me there. I think the Rusev-Roman Reigns build-up tonight was some good feud advancement, and the Cruiserweight showcase was also nice. But other than that, I think there was a lot of stuff that was kind of underwhelming. I did like Lita's interview with Sasha Banks, and I do think that the interview style, the sit-down style, to build up the first-ever Women's Hell in a Cell match was actually well done. On a production note, and so was the constant buildup of Goldberg through video packages and whatnot. I mean, the fact that they made us wait 3 hours is disappointing in a way, but at the same time, I get the reasoning behind it, and I think the WWE production team did a good job of continuing to reinforce it. Hey, he's gonna be here at the end of the night. So overall, this was like a C-plus show for me. Again, some matches that had me kind of losing interest, but I was able to sit through the 3 hours, not fall asleep, and not feel like watching other stuff. I was watching other stuff somewhat. You know, the ALCS is on right now. The you know, some Monday Night Football was on. Boston Bruins were playing. I had three different things that I was watching besides just Raw. But point being made, at least I was able to get through the 3 hours tonight. It wasn't a completely terrible show with nothing going for it. It was all right. Let me know what you guys thought, of course. Be sure to give me a like. Hit that thumbs up button to let me know if you enjoyed this review. Be sure to comment your thoughts and opinions down below in the comment section. And hit the subscribe button for plenty more cool content to come here on the channel. Hope you guys enjoyed the video very much. I thank you so much for watching. And I will be back with you on Thursday for the next video where I'll be talking about Survivor Series 2016. Again, if you have any Q&A questions that you'd like to ask, be sure to do so down in the comment section on any of the videos, and or follow me on Twitter and ask them there. I always live tweet during shows on Twitter, so it's important to follow me there. I also post links to my videos and give you updates on my channel. So that's a great place to get in touch with me and to see what I'm up to. Thanks a lot, guys, and I'll see you next time. Peace out.